Good morning and welcome to worship in our Savior's name here at Immanuel Lutheran Church and Schools. This is a really exciting time of the year, and it's really fun to kind of see all that's happening. This past Wednesday, we had our kindergarten promotion and our sixth grade graduation happen. We have Vacation Bible School starting on June 22nd. There's a sign up at our website at ImmanuelRiverside.com. And probably one of the biggest pieces of news that we have is that we are reopening for sanctuary worship starting next Sunday, June 21st. Pastor Stephen released a video message kind of detailing all the things that are going to change, and I'll leave that link in the description below of that video. But you should know that we have to limit capacity at least for a time. We're limited to about 100 people. And so what will happen today, after this airs on Sunday at noon, we will be sending out an email to just our members with a sign-up list for you to sign up for worship if you so desire. I want you to be encouraged, though, that we are not getting rid of online worship whatsoever. We are still going to continue to record for time being as we still get set up for live streaming so that even if you can't come or you're not comfortable with coming yet, don't worry. You still have time to worship with your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ here on our YouTube channel. So please still continue to serve and worship God and continue to worship with your fellow brothers and sisters. And then the last exciting piece of news that I'm really excited for today is that today marks the beginning of our new summer sermon series on the book of Hebrews. Last week at Drive-Thru Communion, we were handing out these little booklets of just the letter of Hebrews with some ample journaling space in it. And so if you have one of these, you were able to get one for your household, keep it close because we're going to definitely use it during the sermon. If you didn't get one, I'd encourage you to grab a notebook of some sort or grab your Bible and keep it open to Hebrews because we're going to be doing some notating. I want you to take some notes as it will be edifying for our worship as we dive deeper into God's Word, especially coming from the book of Hebrews. There's a lot of great and fantastic things that you'll soon get to hear and experience today as we introduce it. Well, God's richest blessings to you today as He comes to you in His Word.
We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This morning, as we delight in the word of the Lord that comes to us in the book of Hebrews, we are reminded that our Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the Father, upholds the universe by the word of His power. Yet so often we fail to listen and obey His word. Although in the past, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days He has spoken to us by his Son. We've not heeded the calls to repent of the sins that we have committed in thought, word, and deed. Let us now reflect upon those times and ask for mercy from God for the sake of Jesus. Almighty Lord, have mercy on us. Forgive us where we have fallen short and where we have failed to hear your calls to turn from our sin. For the sake of Jesus, who died and rose again, have mercy on us in his name. Amen. Hear the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Is the radiance of the glory of God. He has made the purification for all sins and is seated at the right hand of the Majesty on high. Therefore, for the sake of Jesus' death and resurrection, he forgives us all our sins. In those who believe on his name, he gives power to become the children of God and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, yours is the victory. Hi, good morning, everybody. Hey, have you ever taken a really close look at a chain? Well, I have one here, and it's metal, and they're all individual links that are connected, and they keep everything strong and hold them together. You can carry it by one of them, and they still stay together. That's what a chain is supposed to do. It keeps it nice and strong. Now, I have another chain here that's a little bit different. This one's made of paper, so it's not as strong that way, but it's strong in a different way. This one is strong because of the names that are written on it. Let me read you some of them. There's Andrew and Simon, James and John, Philip and Matthew. Do you know who some of those people are? Well, if you said Jesus' disciples, you're right. This chain is made of the disciples who went with Jesus and listened to him and learned from him. And then they went out and they told other people about Jesus and all the wonderful things he had done. And the chain grew longer. And then more came along, like Paul. And he traveled all around and he told people all of the amazing things about Jesus and the good news that he died and rose for us. And the chain gets even longer. We are also called to go out and teach people about Jesus because there's still lots and lots of folks that don't know about him and his story and his grace and his forgiveness. And the Holy Spirit helps us, and we can be bold and tell people all the wonderful things Jesus has done. Some of the helpers that will go out and do that are Jonah and Zoe and Braden and Justin and Lauren and Carter and Laura. That's the eighth graders that are confirmed this year, and they are now part of the chain to go out and tell others about the wonderful good news of Jesus and our salvation. Now look at this amazing chain, and you're part of the chain too. And this is a chain that will continue to grow and grow, and with you and the Holy Spirit, we can go out and tell more people and grow the chain even longer. And this chain, the strength of it, no one can break it, and it will last for all eternity. Will you pray with me? Dear Jesus, you have given us a big job to share the message of your love with others. Help us remember that you don't ask us to do this alone. We are linked together with you and the Holy Spirit and all other believers, so that together we will be strong. In his name we pray. Amen.
The reading for this morning is the first chapter of the letter to the Hebrews. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making a purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my son, today I have begotten you"? Or again, "I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son"? And again, when he brings the firstborn into the world, he says, "Let all God's angels worship him." Of the angels, he says, "He makes his angels winds and his minister a flame of fire." But of the Son, he says, "Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of uprightness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. And you, Lord, laid the foundation of the earth in the beginning, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment, like a robe, you will roll them up. Like a garment, they will be changed, but you are the same, and your years will have no end. And to which of the angels has he ever said, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are they not all ministering spirits sent out to serve for the sake of those who are to inherit salvation? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 9th and 10th chapters. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly that the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these: first Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, who would betray him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel and proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying, give without pay. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Every kindred, every tribe on this team.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. This past week, I was driving on my way to church, and I was stopped at Victoria and Arlington. It doesn't take too long to get to church from my house, but on occasion, this one light can be a little bit on the longer side. Anyway, a funny thing happened was that I was stopped behind one car, and I had several other cars around me. The first was that there was a car beside me that was absolutely blasting their music, and the song was from Carrie Underwood, "Jesus Take the Wheel." If you don't know what it sounds like, it sounds something like this.
Jesus, take the wheel, take it from my hands, 'cause I can't do this on my own. I'm letting go.
Yeah, something like that. Can I just say that blasting that song out loud is really gutsy, and there's no better song, in my opinion, that'll make people really afraid to drive with you if you're going to let go of the wheel. That's just my personal opinion on that. Anyways, that song was playing, and I could hear it because it was absolutely rocking the car. And then also in front of me was the bumper sticker, "Jesus is my co-pilot." Now, I'm sure you've seen bumper stickers like those, and you might even have one yourself, but two things crossed my mind. The first was, what are the odds of hearing that song being blasted and seeing that bumper sticker in front of me? But the second one was that, in light of our new sermon series on the book of Hebrews, how ridiculous that song and that bumper sticker are to even exist in the first place. Now, trust me when I say that I understand the sentiment behind "Jesus is my co-pilot." I believe it comes from an autobiography that a World War II flying ace had labeled "God is my co-pilot." It's a rather somewhat cleverly named autobiography. But modern-day interpretations have kind of morphed it a bit. There are nuances behind it that I don't think were originally there. It kind of has the feeling of, Jesus is my buddy-buddy. Jesus has my back, sort of sentimentality. And while to some degree we can agree with that, we don't need to worry about the future because, well, Jesus promises to be with us even to the very end of the age. But it has this underlying tone that Jesus is kind of our assistant, that He's a backup in case things go wrong, a get-out-of-jail-free card just in case you get into trouble. And that shouldn't be how we view Jesus at all. You see, today we are beginning a sermon series based off of the book of Hebrews called "Look to Jesus." And we will take a closer look at this through the epistle of Hebrews. As the name of the sermon series sounds, it is very intentionally picked out. It comes from Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. Look to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. Over the course of the summer months, we will continually hear the call to look to Jesus in all circumstances because He has accomplished and fulfilled all righteousness for our sake. Who He is and what He has done was all foreshadowed in times past, as the author of Hebrews will show. This letter was written to a people that had great knowledge of their Old Testament. They knew the promises that God had laid out for them and how it all comes to a head in Jesus, that He holds the past, the present, and ultimately the future, because He is timeless and unchanging. And we get this beautiful introduction today from Hebrews chapter 1 that shows precisely that, a clear picture of who Jesus is, and lets us see, hear, and know the one true God. And it does this by cluing us into the name that is above all other names. You know, I have a lot of friends and even some of my own family members that have given birth already in 2020 or will give birth pretty soon here. And one of the tasks that every parent has to go through is naming their child. A name is important because it sums us up, body and soul, into a personal, proper noun. And so you have those parents who will go through the entire list of the book of baby names. They'll have a March Madness type tournament battling out which name is the best. And of course, the best name at the end is what they name the baby. And it's quite funny because I've known people that if they suggest a name where they know someone else that's already around that shares that name, sometimes they could say, no, I don't like that name. So-and-so was a bully. I don't want my child to be named after that bully. That their name has become tainted because we know someone like that. It's kind of funny to watch. But you also have those parents that will do a deep dive into the language behind names, trying to get at the root of the language so that they can find those qualities or moralities things that are sometimes embedded within names. In either case, a name is important. And it's no different when we look at the confessional introduction of Hebrews 1. So if you have this or your Bible, go ahead and get it out. Turn to Hebrews chapter 1. And I want you to highlight, underline, mark up somehow so you know what I'm talking about. The first thing I want you to do is highlight verse 4, which says this, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. You see, one of the most intimate ways that God lets himself be known in the Old Testament is that he lets the people, the Hebrews, his people, to let him know his name, Yahweh, the Lord. Without it, they have absolutely no access to God and his good gifts to them. It was only by his name that they could even approach him and ask for help. And now God gives us access to himself after he names Jesus, Yahweh, the Lord, the excellent name inherited from God after he is exalted on high. But you see, there's more to it than just an inherited name. In fact, there's three different aspects that I've pulled out of Hebrews chapter 1 that kind of composite into this inherited name. The first is that he has a personal name. He is called the Son of God. Go ahead and highlight Son in verse 2. Go ahead and highlight all of verse 5 and Son in verse 8. Now, all this may seem pretty random as they are strewn about the text, but nothing could be further from the truth. For you see, they closely mirror and even quote a royal psalm, Psalm 2, verse 7. This prayer of the Old Testament tells of the relationship between God setting up his authority for his kingdom, the king. And while we get a glimpse of this in Israel's history and in Israel's kings, the fact is, in Jesus, we see its fulfillment. The sonship that is expressed here shows a royal inheritance. All nations, the ends of the earth, all of creation belongs to Jesus. God says, you are my son. Not to show that Jesus was adopted or achieved this special status, but to show that he is here and now and forever always the Son of God. And the fact is, if God himself testifies to this and acknowledges his sonship, well, then his hearers also confess him as such. The second part of this name is more of a generic family name. That's the name of God. You see, go ahead and underline verse 3, verse 8 now in totality, and verse 9. Verse 3 is kind of where we'll fall here and dive in just a little bit deeper. It's important for us to consider. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. And he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. You see, Jesus is the imprint, the very definition of God's nature, the reflection of it. We only know God because we have seen Jesus. We only know what true sacrificial love, the love of God, looks like because we have seen God in action as he takes on human flesh and take our place on the cross. Only God has the power to uphold the universe by his word. Only God is eternal. And that eternal word, well, he became flesh and dwelt among us. He alone is able to make purification for our sins, and he does so willingly and freely for you. The third aspect is one that we've kind of already talked about, but it's one that he shares part of his name with the Father. He is the Lord, Yahweh, the name above all names. Go ahead and highlight verse 2 and all of verse 10. Here we hear that the Lord is the Lord over all. Everything is subject to him. Having laid the foundation of the earth in the beginning, and heavens are the work of your hands. See, he's not just the mediator of creation. He is its author, the one who laid its foundation. There is no one greater. Think about it this way. If the distance between Earth and the sun, which is 92 million miles, was, for the sake of illustration, reduced to the thickness of a sheet of paper, then the distance between Earth and the closest star, not the sun, the closest one that we know of, would be a stack of paper 70 feet high. And the diameter of our galaxy would be a stack of paper 310 miles high. That's how big the galaxy is. And yet the galaxy is nothing but a speck of dust virtually in the known universe. As we've heard, Jesus holds up this universe together with the word of his power. That's really impressive. Literally authored it into existence. And yet, going back to the bumper sticker and the song, this is the kind of thing that we ask of an almighty creator, sustainer of all, a royal king, is to be our co-pilot, our assistant. I mean, how many times have we treated Jesus as an afterthought? A name that only comes to mind when we're in trouble or things get bad. See, we are prone to cry out to God only when we need something. How quickly we forget to praise his name for the grace that we are shown each and every day. That the Lord, the master of the universe, has called us his own. And perhaps that is something that we need to be mindful of as we keep going forward. How do we use God's name? I want you to write that question somewhere, wherever you're keeping notes this morning. I want you to write it somewhere. How do we use God's name? Do we serve it? Do we honor it in reverence? Or do we use it flippantly? Do we degrade it? Do we wipe it through the mud? Whatever it is, and it doesn't need to be public, I want you to think about that. After today's worship service, I want you to actually answer that question. Have you been using God's name? But in the meantime, I also want you to know this, that God's name is kept holy, perfect, pure, apart from our use of it. It is because of who God is and his nature that he willingly purifies us with his blood. It is the Son who takes his name and humbles himself to the point of dying like a common criminal on the cross, bearing the weight of all our sins, even how we misuse his name. His name becomes equated with sinners, so that sinners are exalted with his name. Because as he died and rose again, that sin completely destroyed. Because that's who He is. We hear about this in Acts chapter 4, verses 11 through 12. It says, "This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." Thanks be to God for who God is. That's why the name of God is placed on you in your baptism. You become co-heirs of these promises of God purely for the sake of Jesus. We are saved because of who Jesus is, and there is no other name by which we must be saved. What great and precious news as we begin this new journey into Hebrews. In the following weeks, we will continue to hear more and more about the name above all names, how deep it goes within our history. And my hope and encouragement for you is that you'll start looking to Jesus and understanding how He has authored saving faith for you, what that exactly means, and how He perfects it so that you are shaped to be little imprints of Jesus here, right and now. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in you, bring it to completion on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His name, in His glorious name, amen.
Having heard the good news, let us now confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day He rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And He will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us take our petitions of praise and thanksgiving to the Lord now. Let us pray. Lord, we lift up your church and her witness of hope to the world, that in every city, village, and home across the globe, your voice may be heard by the faithful preaching of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who labor in the fields of the Lord today, and for you to raise up laborers for your harvest fields, that their work may be blessed and they may be protected and defended against the enemies of the kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, protect and guide our synod, our congregation, and pastors. We seek the resources to accomplish what you would have given us to do, despite all obstacles and temptations, so that united in the faith, we may serve you with joy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all who live under the flag of our nations, for those who govern in this country, and for the causes of peace and justice, that we may all be given grace and freedom to serve the Lord honorably and in accord with your word, we pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up the poor and hungry, the homeless and unemployed, and the oppressed, that the Lord would grant them mercy, and that we may help to relieve their suffering and want. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the sick, that the Lord would grant them healing. For the wounded in spirit, that the Lord would make them whole. And for the grieving, that the Lord would comfort them, especially all affected by the ongoing pandemic and its effects. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who know the riches of the Lord's blessings, that they may cheerfully return to the Lord the tithes and offerings of a grateful church, a grateful heart, and give generously to the many agencies of the church working to help those in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we ask for blessings upon the preparations to return to sanctuary worship next Sunday. With joy, we anticipate the celebration of our Savior in physical proximity with each other. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O blessed Lord, through Moses you called the people to yourself, and from them you delivered up to your own Son to be our Savior. By his sufferings and death, he has redeemed us sinners from our sins. And by his resurrection, he has released us from the fear of death. Help us to live as your own people, doing the good works for which we were created and praying with confidence the petitions and supplications of our hearts. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
And now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now receive the benediction of our Lord. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus, name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord, Immanuel, God is with us, blessed Redeemer.